BBC Radio One Extra Stories. Discover more.
I'm Fabio.
I'm Groove Rider.
We're here to tell the story of Fabio and Groove Rider, aka the story of drum and bass.
Fabio and Groove Rider, it means the same as drum and bass. They're the originators.
They are pretty much responsible for paving the way to where it is today.
They more than helped build this scene. They built the scene.
Kingpins, forefounders, torchbearers.
They're godfathers, aren't they?
They're some cool guys, very fun guys, key purveyors since day zero.
They've actually been around since before the start.
Big players in terms of supporting drum and bass.
They were definitely an inspiration to us.
If it wasn't for them two, I wouldn't be making drum and bass right now. I don't think it'd exist.
Fish and chips, rice and peas, Bang & Olufsen, certified partnership that you can rely on.
I've got history with them, Mandy, just like a mutual respect thing.
Heart's in the right place, really passionate about music.
They are family, they are legends, man.
Fabio and Groove Rider, two milestones stuck to music they believed in. Look what's happened, it's got really big now.
Oh, thanks guys, really appreciate that.
Yeah, big shout out to everyone for
standing up.
Absolutely, man.
You'll be hearing more from those guys later on.
But first we take you back to where it all began.
One, two, get down!
I grew up in Brixton. In the 70s, you just couldn't escape music. Growing up in South London on the high street, there was about 7-8 record shops. Whatever music you was into, you had signatures, like jazz boys wore the King Slippers with tight trousers. You know, the reggae boys used to walk around with a thing called a sticks band. With Crocs and Farrah's, the Beachy tops.
Yeah, Burberry's big.
Burberry was big massive. Back then. Everyone had their own little kind of uniform, but everyone kind of hated each other. Because I remember even being a funk boy, the jazz boys used to hate us. Growing up in my household was another important thing. All my family was into music.
I'm Judy, Fabio's sister. The atmosphere was very vibrant, very lively. My parents always had parties. There'd be music playing, Bob Marley to John Holt. My cousin used to go to a club in Stratton called Bally High, and she used to sneak my brother out with her. So she'd dress him up in like a cheesecloth shirt and a skinny tie. And he was only about 14. And so he used to go there, listen to music and really dance. And it was just old school soul, you know, funk, Motown. And I think that inspired him even more. Bedroom was just upstairs. At one stage, I remember I couldn't even open the door. And when I did, I had to climb over like thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of records. And I could just literally stand in a little corner like this. His bed was hidden with records. I think he slept on top of the records. And when I had my 16th birthday party, he was the one that was playing records on my dad's broken record player. And everyone loved it.
I'm his dad. Seems like he did have music in his blood anyway, because I always have my radiogram, you know. I never expect him to become a DJ or anything like that, because he was a bit shy growing up. So I'm proud, you know, I'm very much proud of him.
He is, though. He's very proud. It makes me feel good, because, you know, you want acceptance from your father. When we started out, my dad wasn't happy with the whole fact I wanted to play music. DJing weren't as it is now. DJs was like a man that used to carry his sound system with his lights and everything about, and it weren't a career. So my dad was a bit like, what are you doing? But as I've got older and he's seen everything that's happened, he's really, really proud of me. That age as well, you know, he was worried about the friends that I was running with. I used to bring Nuff Man to the house and he used to be like, oh, I don't like him. And Groove was the only person he liked. That's the the thing. That's the thing about with me and Groove. We've got a very personal relationship. It runs deeper than just being Fabio and Groove Rider. There's a lot of deep love there between me and Groove.
Yeah.
We don't ever say it.
Don't need to, because it sounds very odd.
Yeah, it sounds very odd, but there is.
Not to this day we had an argument.
No, we don't argue.
In 25 years. Yeah, people fall out sometimes. We've never fallen out in 25 ever. Years. Don't get me wrong, I know that he doesn't like every single thing that I've done. And I know he doesn't agree with every single thing that I've done. He'll never tell me. Yeah, that's alright. Yeah. That's what you call a friend.
Yeah, it's true. It's true, man. Let's get it on. So what about you, Groove?
I grew up late 70s, not early ones like yours. I'm not going to lie about it. Certain parts of my life, I went down the wrong road. You do what your friends do, pretty much. I know it's not the right thing to do, but I was a kid, man, and I didn't really know any better. I discovered music by hanging out with some guys, a different set of guys than I used to hang out with. I used to go to some parties and listen to a bit of soul and funk and all that. We was growing up in a time where it was difficult for a young black guy.
You got to remember, when we was going out in early 80s, it was very segregated. As a black person, you still found it very difficult getting into clubs. There weren't no real unity.
We were the real minority. Bouncers automatically think because you're black, you're going to start causing trouble. When I went to a club once, the guy said to me, "You got to come in here with a girl." I was like, "Sorry?" We found a couple of girls. We walked to the door and the guy said to us, "I don't like your aftershave." We were growing up around the time of the skinhead. Skinheads really didn't like the black man or the Asian man. For you to be traced down Streatham High Street wasn't uncommon. So, you know, it was hard growing up. I met some friends who was into scratching and all that. You know, this is the times when techniques had just landed in the country and it was all hype. You know, hip-hop had just landed. I went to a record shop called My Price one day and met a guy called Jazzy M. He played some music, man. It was, like, different. Then he played this tune, "Baby Wants to Ride," with Jamie Principle. I was like, whoa. Baby wants to ride, so high. Baby wants to ride. That's a tune. Let's play me some more. Took all my wages for the week, right? Because I was actually like an accounts clerk, doing some like boring job at the time. Got a little treat for you, one of my earliest mixtapes. Play that beat.
Here we go!
Time to come along! And that's a groove rider, you see.
Yeah, it was a totally different world back then.
One extra.
Here's Ronnie Size.
There was this era where travellers, minorities of different areas used to get together, set up sound systems in fields. It was like the free spirit and anything goes mentality and the crazy energy.
Hello?
Excuse me, mate. Can you tell me where the meeting place is for that jam happening tonight? What's it called? Zenity, Energy, Remedy, happening down at Sabotia.
Well, mate, what you do, you go around the roundabout, you see the light, you turn left, you go in the flat, and you see a petrol station, right? Stay in here, mate, we'll pick you up, right?
So how much is it to get in, then?
It's 20 quid, mate.
20 quid? I thought it was £10 to get in.
No, man, it's not a remix.
The rave scene was thriving through the early 90s and using a lot of elements of what I grew up with, like hip-hop or bits of reggae, bits of pop music, a mishmash of sounds being played in crazy fields or on pirate radio stations. The rave scene was absolutely the most important thing that happened in dance music.
Yeah, this is Dynamite MC checking in. Rave was exciting because it was kind of forbidden. My experiences were in warehouses and fields, and you didn't know where it was, and you waited in a car park for a car to drive through the middle with the hazard lights on, and that was the guy you had to follow. So you'd follow the car and you'd get somewhere, and you know, you'd see the lights and you'd hear the music, and it was a very, very exciting time.
I was taken to an aircraft hangar somewhere in the middle of Oxford. We just walked up, you know, after obviously going to the petrol stations and hearing the word of where to go, who to follow and that sort of thing. And we turn up this aircraft hangar with all these people just dancing around to this music, which is crazy. It was completely different from what I was into. Small clubs with hip-hop in it, moody dudes all around you every minute. This is DJ Bailey. The late 80s, the hip-hop became a little bit too mellow and I liked it rough, you know, really fast and hard breaks. And the house had that, and it had the vibe from the people, so that just was an instant win for me.
Tony Coleman, also known as London Electricity. Yeah, there was this kind of breakbeat hardcore thing coming through. It wasn't very fast, it was about 130, 135 BPM, but it seemed so fast. It was like, that's much faster than house music. What's going to happen with this music? What's going to happen with this music? What's going to happen with this music? What's going to happen with this music?
BBC Radio One Extra Stories. Discover more.
I knew about Fabio because we were both on the same radio station, Phase One.
That's right.
Like, we never saw each other, really. We were the only two people, like, probably in South London playing Acid House. And Mendoza clicked, like, ooh, I might be onto something here.
Yes, he did.
He had a little underground club underneath the radio station. And it was like an after-hours place. Police didn't, like, pay any attention to it. It's just, like, one of them things. He said to me, yeah, I want you to do a little night for me. I goes, what, playing Acid House? He goes, yeah. I was playing the music. I love the music, but I'd never been to a club. So he said to me, yeah, you can do it with Fabio. I goes, what, Fabio? You play Acid House too? I was kind of hating a bit because I was wanting to be the only person playing that. So, like, went to the club, met Fabio, and that's where I first met him.
Yeah.
And then it started to be a couple more nights a week. It seemed to work for us, so why break the bond, man? We've done our own security.
Yeah, we've done our own security, you know. Because we used to watch the money. I mean, we used to make sure that we're getting paid.
If we come out with 30 quid for the night, we've done good.
Oh, we was happy, man. It wasn't a problem to us.
It wasn't a problem.
We didn't care. We were just so happy.
Just to be playing.
To be playing music.
When I actually realised that he was a very good DJ, I mean, I always say he was a good DJ anyway, because he's my brother. But I'd say it was when he done a night at Mendoza. He bought just a few records. But he was playing them, and then another one was going, another one, and he was mixing it a bit. I was like, oh my God, he's actually really good. I'm Judy, Fabio's sister. Mendoza's was very dark, grimy. You'd call them like shubbins, because they were like unlicensed venues. Health and safety was just a nightmare, but you didn't care because you'd get in. Sweatbox, really packed, very, very dark. You couldn't even see where you were standing, who you were standing next to, and just loud, heavy music.
First night, let me tell you something. I've never ever told you this, you know. I saw you pick up the mic and shout Acid. I didn't know what the hell you was doing. I was like, what is this geezer doing? I didn't know about that. It freaked me out. I gotta be honest, I was thinking that Fabio's a weird dude, man. But I realised that's how it went down.
He's never told me that, you know. Never ever told me that.
Yeah,
I don't remember doing that. And I knew he was thinking, what are you doing?
Lost me, man. I was like, whoa, what's going on?
Have locks on top of his head, so like a high top with locks coming down, and he would probably wear jeans with maybe like splits at the side and maybe a polo neck and a leather jacket.
Yeah, I grew didn't have locks.
No, I didn't have no locks.
I had the little locks.
My parents weren't having
yeah.
What was I busting? I remember busting what I was busting today, Converse. Little bandana thing, yeah, dungarees.
Yeah, man.
Smiley face t-shirt. Yeah, it all used to come out. Proper little Acid, man.
I'm MC Conrad.
the rave scene. That used to fuel the drum and bass scene immensely. The style of partying represented with the sound. You know, it was very hardcore, very, you know, DIY. And with the Criminal Justice Bill, you had to start moving back into clubs.
This is Newsbeat.
The Criminal Justice Bill became the law of the land this morning. Over the past year, the bill has sparked fierce protests across the country.
The organisers blame the police for being heavy-handed with people inside Hyde Park who were dancing to loud music. They say it was provocative to charge them with horses and claim that the violence that followed was inevitable.
The police have new powers to stop unlicensed raves if they believe music played outdoors at night is likely to cause distress to local people. Home Secretary Michael Howard.
People should be free to behave as they wish to behave, as long as they don't interfere with the freedom of other people.
European states, one great dance movement and a clash of attitudes. Hundreds of thousands of young people from across Europe descended on Berlin at the weekend at the invitation of the city authorities. They took over the city streets for the annual Love Parade in celebration of techno music. In Britain, since the introduction of the Criminal Justice Act, it is illegal to organise an outdoor rave without a licence. So here, the weekend was marked with events to signal defiance of the authorities.
I absolutely believe that. Once the music was no longer being a free spirit in the field and then it was pushed into a corner in nightclubs, that is when the music changed dramatically. That's when it became a lot more intense, a lot more industrial, dark. You can hear the anger coming out in the music. Hey, this is Ronnie Size representing. The way that I went into the studio and made my music was very, very different. You know, when I used to make an anthem, I used to make an anthem for the 6 o'clock sun. You know, as soon as I went into the clubs, I started making anthems to get the rewind, to get the reload for the majority peak time at 1 o'clock.
My name is Mickey Finn, and I remember one night, and I'm not exaggerating, these were the days when things would maybe go about 8 times, 9 times. It got to the point where it's like, you know, come and let the record play, you know.
That's where it kind of really started, I think, like rewinding tunes.
Randall, everyone knows me as DJ Randall.
It was just like the heat of the moment, like we just do a mix. It was so good that people would just say, just rewind the whole mix. It was just like a spontaneous thing. And the crowd and everyone would be just slapping the walls.
Some of the early clubs were definitely legendary. Vibe was like something that you'll never ever see again.
And I remember Spectrum met Groove outside.
Yeah, Steve Jackson,
man. Steve Jackson.
House DJ of the time.
And we saw him outside the club trying to blag his way to get in there, getting mugged off by security.
That was one lesson that I learned that night. Don't go shouting your name off at clubs. I'm Steve Jackson. So?
We were crying with laughter. Yeah. We were rolling around on the floor. Yeah, we did get in there.
Yeah.
We were just walking around in a daze. I've never seen a DJ have that much power over a crowd. This was hero different. Worship. It was different. Those nights at Heavens changed a lot of things. It made us see DJing in a different way, see how powerful a DJ was for the first time, and that was a big, big moment for us.
No doubt. There was a girl called Debbie. She said, I can get you in there. Yeah, you can go and do the upstairs room in Heaven for like a couple of hours. I was like, shut up. Okay, let's go and have it. So I called Fabio in. We played upstairs and absolutely smashed it. We were taking people away from the main dance floor. Got so good in there that the dude who was running it, Kevin Millen, said, you know what? Let's try you downstairs, like in the main room.
Yeah, that was rage, man. Rage, man.
I'm Sarah from Groove Connection.
Rage was absolutely unbelievable. You just knew that you were in somewhere cutting edge. You just felt it, you know. We just all used to go totally wild in there. All I'd do is go to Rage, and once I started dancing, didn't come off the dance floor till the end, you know. We'd all drop down totally sweaty.
My name is Mickey Finn. It was a groundbreaking club. In Rage, near the bar, where I come from, there used to be, every Thursday, 30 or 40 of us. That was our plot.
That was where I really kind of got turned on to this music. I can remember the first night we had to get membership. We waited outside for 3.5 hours and managed to just hear 1 hour of Groove Rider, but we were still excited that this was worth it.
DJ Storm's absolutely right. This is Bailey. I do the One Extra Drum and Bass show every Wednesday. And actually, not a lot of people know that I was on the road with Groove Rider for many years, carrying his records for him, the box boy, basically. That was like my actual real club experience with lasers going off, people just having it. They're not even looking at each other. They're in their own zone. And I was just like, yeah, I hadn't seen that before. It was just really unique.
Right, stealing Jeff from Val.
And I just remember classic tunes getting dropped on the dance floor and me just standing there being amazed by it, and the lasers going off and the sound system was banging. It was just an amazing experience.
It was a massive part of Fabio and Groove Rider.
But it's a massive part of music culture. Yeah. A lot of things sprung out of that.
Yeah. It weren't cosy in there, do you know what I mean? It was like off-key in there and...
Do you know what I liked about Rage? I used to see all my football mates and they used to be like shouting on the terraces on a Saturday. But when it comes to a Thursday, we all love each other.
Yeah, man.
And that's what like broke down a lot of like the racism was through the music.
Yeah. The way we just went across the board and mixed black and white music together, it helped. Rage was one of the only clubs you used to go and see black and white people really getting on and just loving the music. That's a game changer.
Yo, this is GQ, man. Big up.
Rage for me used to be a special place. I was going there for Groove and Fabio. They was playing tunes which would ambush you. They'd just sneak up on you and just hit you at the back of your head and you'd be like, what the hell is that?
DJ Randall. It was the era where it was kind of like cheesy still, little squeaky vocals, and then it just changed.
Suddenly a new sound attracts everyone's attention.
It just turned all of a sudden, so I couldn't exactly tell you where that term jungle came from.
Jungle was born out of Rage. Born out of Rage. You used to find like little hip-hop tracks, Calm Down, Most Wanted, that's the most prolific one.
Yeah, yeah,
I think.
Yeah. Because it had the breakbeat and it had a kind of like sub-bass thing going on.
Yeah.
I've never heard anything like that tune. Even now, you listen back to that tune,
yeah,
it sounds like a drum and bass tune.
It's the world and it's music. To me, it's rap. I'm ready to get stupid on a calm down track. So step to the side, better yet, the rear. I was super pain, so your mind is clear. They'll plant you, feed you, grow you like a flower. Like Nintendo, now you're playing with power. Around the edges, I melt the wedges. When you're stuck, you got the message.
It's funny because we were black DJs and we had a different slant on how to play music. A lot of the DJs were playing vocal and we weren't. We were playing rhythm tracks.
Yeah.
Me and Groove used to play the instrumentals and we used to get slagged off for it. All the real house people used to be like, why don't you play the vocal version? We was never into the vocal versions. We was into the B-sides.
It was the wrong mix.
That's what we used to say.
We used to like put them up from 33 onto 45. So we used to speed the track up. Creating a whole different genre of music. That was the birth of jungle. Nobody can't say anything to that. That's the bottom line of it.
It was fire. It was going off differently when these tracks were being played. And then our mate, Danny, when we used to play these tunes, he used to shout jungle.
Well, it was. Jungle for him was something else, but I used to like shouting it. Right? I'm not going to say what it was because it's not that hard to figure out. And then it just became a term. So I don't care what anybody else wants to say. That is where it come from.
Now, hear this. This sound and a dibby dibby sound. This are the wickedest sound and gargling in town. So follow it out.
Yo, this is Dynamite MC.
They pioneered the music and done it in excellent style and fashion.
MCGQ, they are kings. If it wasn't for them pushing, you know, the music and everything from way, way back, this whole thing might have not been how it is.
My name's Dillinger. Vibe started there, it kind of started there. The vibes for producers getting into it and deciding that I want to start using breakbeats now.
Yeah, yeah, it was definitely born there. Probably about 91.
Big up Fab Groove from Less Water Foresight.
DJ Bailey, Internetti.
If there isn't a bunch of people doing it, you don't have a genre. But Fab Groove did definitely pioneer it, you know. They would get the tunes earlier. They were the go-to DJs, like, play this first. Because people knew that they had the ears of everybody, the latest stuff. Listen to Fabio and Groove Rider, that's how it was. So they were at the forefront of it.
Hi, my name's DJ Kenny Ken.
So everyone started to make their breakbeat music, but with the floor to the floor. Then all of a sudden, we just took the floor to the floor away. Then got called Jungle. They ain't looked back since.
My name is Mickey Finn. You're in the heart of cutting plates time. That is when plates was fashionable and you saw every DJ down Music House. It was like, sometimes, no exaggeration, you're coming out of places at 5 in the morning, you know. You're going there 3 times a week because you just got that one extra tune that you need.
Yeah, this is one of the signs representing.
Jungle was definitely about taking the chopped up breakbeat, low 808 sub basses, and, you know, just taking the raw elements and just putting it together with a mishmash of like time stretching vocals and ragga vocals, hip hop vocals.
For me, a very important Jungle tune is We Irene. It's kind of what me and Groove Rider were trying to do. It's got the kick drum and it's got the Amen break on it as well.
This is Bailey, I do the One Extra Drum and Bass Show.
These guys took what they did on the dance floor and brought it to radio, which is important. So it just created its own scene. If it wasn't on the air, it wouldn't be where we are now, because that's the only way to service the people.
Yo, this is GQ.
Pirate radio was the major importance of our music.
There's men, they're putting their life on the line, climbing up roofs and setting up certain things and all that, do you know what I mean, aerials and that, so, you know, they could broadcast to the people to let people know what was going on. It's the information centre.
My name's Dillinger. You had all the pirate station, they weren't up to scratch. When Groove and Fab's show came along, it was like quality music. That was the music I preferred that they were playing, do you know what I mean? Pirates were playing bits and bobs that I liked, but the proper quality stuff that you hear in Rage, it was only them that were playing it on their show, so that was the best drum and bass show ever.
Hello, my name's John B. I'd listen to them on the radio, like, even before they were on Radio 1. That was how you got to hear the brand new underground stuff. My dad would record their show religiously every week and post it up to me on cassettes. For someone that was a proper geek at school and really square, basically, it was amazing to sort of be able to hear this really cool underground stuff and feel like you were becoming part of a scene and were in on, like, something really cool.
We were doing our show at Kiss, and the other guys were doing shows on Cool FM back then, Sunrise. What was the one Randall was on?
Centre Force.
Yeah, that's what was kind of holding the scene together.
We were the only ones that kind of broke out and was really playing drum and bass and jungle on any legal station.
There's something from us guys taken from way back on Kiss FM.
Yeah, before the break, we had the A-Dan, Tribal Warfare. Because as they say, a calm before a storm. Here comes the jungle. This is Code 017, White Label style, Jungle Business. Those dark white labels coming out of London right now. That's Code 017. Some Jungle Business. Don't even know the name of that one. That's White Label.
Yeah, that's a white label for you, man. That's where they roll nowadays.
Some of that's from last week sometime.
BBC Radio One Extra Stories. Discover more.
Jungle is massive.
This is Fabio and Groove Rider. This is the story of us. This is the story of drum and bass on BBC Radio One Extra. One Extra.
You know what, I think Jungle went through a funny time because Jungle was big, but Jungle was also very problematic, you know, shootouts, and it was all getting a little bit dicey, and there was some unsavoury characters getting involved, and I just think things just really had to change.
People were taking the jungle thing out of context. They were believing that all the ragga material was jungle. That wasn't the case.
Yeah, you're right. It was getting a bit silly, you know.
Comical.
There was like comedy jungle tunes, and it was getting more and more taken away from the music.
I'm Sarah from Groove Connection. The jungle scene had suddenly sort of exploded, and there was definitely a rougher side creeping in. There was a lot of fighting going on. It just wasn't enjoyable. You know, you had to watch where you were going, and that wasn't the reason why I was a raver or, you know, into the music.
Yeah, this is Ronnie Side. It then evolved into a more accessible form, which then became drum and bass. Drum and bass was the more musical elements of jungle or rave.
It was just beautiful. It just opened up so many things. This is Sensei. I could just hear where, you know, things could go, and I just knew it was the best thing to happen from jungle.
LTJ Booker.
Around that kind of 93, 94 stage, the scene kind of started to grow and people really started to venture down the dark avenue, the musical avenue, the jazz avenue, techno kind of sound avenue. So people kind of explored different sides of where we kind of come from.
That's why Speed just came about. Sarah from Groove Connection decided to set up a night with a guy called Leo in the West End. Drum and bass is kind of being born, do you know what I'm saying?
We actually sat down and said, what are we going to call this music? We decided between us to call it drum and bass. You know, we knew it was different from jungle and we had to make some kind of differentiation. I honestly think that's where drum and bass was born.
Yeah, I'm Danny LTJ Bookham. It was a coming together of heads, really. Just basically me and Fabio wanting to just play our music out and playing just from the heart.
There wasn't many people down there, but there was a potential that me and Kemi felt we needed this place, we needed this vehicle for all these tunes that weren't being played on the dance floor. So we phoned all these people that we didn't know, Fotex or Starrett, we found their numbers and we just said, look, there's this club where your music's being played, you've got to come down, bring your friends, do you know what I mean?
It was quite empty actually, it was really hard to get people in there, and then you move it to a Thursday and that's when it kind of really changed. I turned up to the Astoria, and it's like just between the Astoria and the opposite Astoria, so I'm walking down and I see a queue coming out from that road. I'm like, oh no, I wonder what's going on at Astoria tonight. That's going to mess up our do. As I'm getting closer, I'm like, that is our do. I'm like, what's going on? And from that night, for like the next 2 years or whatever, every week, it was like that. It's crazy.
Just kick-started the whole drum and bass scene. You suddenly found pockets of people wanting to hear that kind of sound rather than the jungle sound all across the country, you know. And it attracted a whole new crowd, which was a lot more student-based. And a lot of girls started coming back out, you know. A lot of women thought, oh, yeah, I like this sound.
It was such a passionate event. It caught so many people's hearts, and so many people used to come down there from so many different scenes, from, like, Simply Red and pop artists to techno guys, because of the energy.
My name's John B. That was one of the first drum and bass parties I ever went to, actually, and everyone who was anyone in drum and bass was there, and I was like, oh my God, there's LTJ Bookham, there's Dillinger, there's Chemistry and Storm. And it was when Goldie was with Bjork, and I'm standing there dancing next to Bjork.
I remember seeing Giles Peterson, his little head bopping away below me every week. You just saw smiling faces, dancing, sweating, just totally into the music. There was just nothing pretentious about the whole thing. It was just to the core music lovers. It just broke down the barriers.
You know, you could go down there and just let off with like-minded people. MC Conrad
here. The peak of Speed, you know, you had Grace Jones coming down and David Bowie. I think the Gallagher brothers got refused entry.
Liam had been up with one of Steps all night.
It didn't matter who you was, if there was no space, you just weren't getting it. It did become a bit of a cool place to be, but for the right people, you know, people that do kind of go out on a maverick mission to look for something different.
And the amount of music that was made in that time is phenomenal. So when producers that come down would just hear stuff, then they'd go home and be in the studio. I was up till like whatever time in the morning, and it really kind of influenced a lot of people. Me and Fabio were doing the influencing.
It's kind of religious. I've heard Fabio quote it as being like church, and it was.
Then you had the flip side. You had metalheads. They used to call metalheads church as well. You know, used to get schooled out on Sunday. Where Speed was more harking back to soul days, metalheads was like the future. It was forward thinking. You know, metalheads came at a time where digital music started. There wasn't that before. You know, everything you hear now, and I'm talking even dubstep, came from those moments. Groove played Mutant Jazz to me, and I'd never heard a tune like that before. It was futuristic. The first time I've ever heard jungle sound, like, wow, this is like what I expect to be on Tron soundtrack. It was like science fiction.
Metalheads was a club where you could go and play anything, and that's what the point of it was. But yeah, a lot of people used to play a bit harder in there, yeah. I used to run the whole thing, to be totally honest with you. Goldie just dropped Timeless.
Oh,
going really well and he wasn't able to run the club how it needed to be run, so he left it to me. Booking the DJs, playing it myself and, you know, just keeping it all in order.
This is Bailey. I do the One Extra Drum and Bass show every Wednesday. I gave birth there, but that's not possible, is it? That's where I was born, basically. It wasn't until I got to Metalheads and became a resident in about 95 that I really started to get recognised as a DJ. Sound system, you can hear it just coming out of the basement. Eskimo Noise supplied the sound system. Up until then, I don't think anyone had hired their own sound system to do a club, and they brought all their bass bins. It was like it took up room on the floor. It just shook the place. So you stood outside hearing that, and you just opened the doors, and it's just like heat in your face, the crunchiest bass lines in your face. It wasn't a big secret, but you felt you was somewhere where it was like, yeah, this is something real special, you know what I mean? It was where everybody learned how to sort of expand and broaden their horizons musically.
Yeah, my name is Mr. Gary, aka GQ, the Lyrical Miracle One.
If a man drop a tune and the tune got to me, especially if I had a couple of brandies, then you're gonna know about it.
And they had to book me for my LS as well. You understand what I mean? I kind of like read the music, yeah, and some parts of the music doesn't need touching, and it was really interesting as well because certain people was making tunes which had so much edits in there where they was playing about with breaks and things like that, you know what I mean, more than the norm. So you might be, you know, rolling at 16 bars, you know what I mean, or thing or whatever, and then, you know, an edit might catch you off guard. It was really interesting and it was fresh.
You have to always say that Metalheads loves its breaks, you know what I mean? Yeah, we've always had up-in-your-face breaks.
You know what, DJ Storm's absolutely right about that. It was just the place to listen to experimental drum and bass with no boundaries, no one trying to fit in, everyone just trying to outdo each other with the really weirdest stuff they could do. As long as it sounded slightly like edgy and a bit like you listen to it and if it makes you feel a bit creepy, then you had the right sound. And that's what made it special.
London Electricity.
The thing that really, really stays with me is how amazing the structure of tunes was and the way people DJed, like the way Groove DJed. It wasn't about showing off how good his laptop is and his software is so he can triple drop everything. It was actually about selection. It was about the music. And it was really about innovation. Completely brand new sounds, brand new structures, brand new techniques. That was a time of absolutely intense creation within drum and bass, within music in general. Drum and bass was spearheading things.
My name is Nick from Subfocus. Well, I first saw Groove Rider play, I think, at one of the last Metalheads nights of the Blue Note, midway through my teens, so I sort of sneakily managed to get in. I remember basically being pretty starstruck because I was sort of seeing lots of these artists that I was being listened to for sort of years. Really left an impression. I heard loads of sort of classic tunes when I went down there, tracks like Alien Girl and Brand New Funk.
Yeah, Blue Note was such an influential club.
Hi, I'm John B from Beta Recordings.
You'd want Groove Rider to play your track and you'd take your DATs and give them to the select people, and I'd sit in a little booth on my own with a can of Red Stripe just listening, you know, sort of mentally taking notes, and very important in the scene, I think.
You know, Groove was kind of doing Metalheads, I was doing Speed, but we were both getting recognised for playing at two of the best nights anywhere you could go to. So Fabio and Groove Rider was still going even though we were separate, do you know what I mean? Fabio and Groove Rider was still running things even when we were apart.
You dream of heaven.
Prototype Recordings came about because I wanted to make tunes. It wasn't a major thing, just wanted to do some music, that's all. A few people liked what I did and said, yeah, Groove, you want to put some tunes out? I thought, I don't know about that, sounds like hard work. But I took on a couple of guys, firstly, really, Ed Rush and Optical. Had a couple of hits with them, I was like, whoa, this is not too bad, and these guys were really good to work with. Ended up doing something with Dillinger.
Every tune that he picked for that label, yeah. Pinnacle of Groove for me. Prototype Recordings took me back to Rage. Just Groove all day through Prototype.
Lemon D.
You had the people at the forefront of the scene and we're coming through and there are role models in the music and that's what they chose from us.
Simon Bassline Smith.
Me and Drumsound had just done a new tune. I just sent it over to Groove Rider and he wanted to sign it there and then. Everybody wanted it, but no one could get it off Groove Rider until he was ready to give it to them. That was like a big breakthrough moment for us because Prototype Recordings is obviously one of the biggest and best drum and bass labels from day dot.
DJ Fresh, Bad Company,
I was in a group called Bad Company. Maybe the second or the third track that we did was a track called Pulse. Groove Rider, he was literally like a god to me. I could barely even like talk to him when I saw him because I was so nervous. And he said, you know, are you interested in signing it to Prototype? And I was like, what? Prototype? And I think that was kind of really what kicked everything off for us and probably for me as well. If you got a Prototype release, it was like winning an award. It was like guaranteed to become a historic tune.
Just evolved from there, really.
My name's John B. One of my biggest breaks, really, was getting a track on Prototype on Groove Rider's label. I'd sent a cassette demo to Groove, and the last track on this cassette was Secrets, and the tape had cut off. I put it on as an afterthought, like, oh, he might like it, but I don't know. And I was playing table tennis in the back garden with my friend Charlie. The home phone rings. My mum comes out, she says, there's a Mr. Groove on the phone for you. I could hear Secrets playing in the background. He's like, what, John? Yeah, I want this tune. I was like, oh my god. For a DJ like that to be playing your music, that's awesome. But for them to like something you've done that much that they want to like invest in you to release it on their label, it's great. And it really helped me out to have that support. Cool honor, I think.
Groove Rider's harder sound. I found elements of it stayed more faithful to jungle techno.
This is Sensei.
Tracks were just so good and so melodic and full, and the engineering's amazing on all those tracks. You know, Groove Rider's got his ear to the ground, you know, with sound.
You alright, we're the Prototypes.
Yeah, we named ourselves Prototypes after his label. No, we didn't really. It just comes from an advert. We thought Groove might not be too happy about it.
It's turned out all good.
He supported us massively.
Tunes that were released on that label, some of them were probably changing to drum and bass.
Stone Cold classics, definitely bringing artists that we hadn't heard of before to our eyes.
I'm DJ Fresh. When we started our label, my label with Adam F, Breakbeat Chaos, we saw ourselves as being more like Prototype than some of the other labels, more about special tunes rather than lots of tunes.
There is a secret song.
BBC Radio One Extra Stories.
Critics all started because a lot of the tunes I was playing was just getting signed up by people and doing really, really well. And I sat down and thought to myself, well, I can't keep giving these tunes out to people and them just kind of like running off of these tunes. So I just thought, you know, it'd be good to start a label, which was at the time everyone was doing as well. You know what I mean? It was part of the whole DJ process was having your own label. And Heaven was the first tune on the label.
Bailey.
Fabio and Creative Source, he was always the real smoother type selector, you know. He really loved the music and he still does it now, you know what I mean. Big up Fabio for sticking to what he believes in. If we didn't have that label out there, a lot of that sound would have got lost, because there was a few smaller labels around it that came and went real quick, but Fabio stuck by it. Without Fabio, we probably wouldn't have that style floating around now. Just wouldn't be happening.
London Electricity.
When we started Hospital, me and Chris went to see Vinyl Distribution, who were the drum and bass distributor. And I remember going into Vinyl's offices and just seeing in picture frames, Creative Source release, Creative Source release, Creative Source release. And I remember thinking, can we ever be as big and important as Creative Source? You know, it was really something to aim for. Highly, highly inspirational label. We wouldn't have done things the way we did without Creative Source being there.
Creative Source was one of the foundation labels of Liquid Funk.
Hi, this is High Contrast.
It's got a fantastic back catalogue. Those early releases from people like Carlito and Addiction were records that I traipsed around the underground record shops hunting down the vinyl for, and were, you know, big inspirations on me. It's great that it continues on now, and those tunes influence people like Netsky and Fred V and Graphics, who are blowing up now, so there's a definite kind of lineage.
BBC Radio One Extra Story.
Yeah, we're Fred V and Graphics. I'm Fred V.
I'm Graphics.
I remember when I got given my decks, they were second-hand decks, and they came with a Creative Source EP. I didn't even know what drum and bass was, but I just started making music like that.
Yeah, Creative Source has always pushed and released great music. We still, to this day, include some of the tracks in our sets.
Yeah, no, it's really good to see new kids coming through now. They're still growing up on what we was playing back in the day, and that's the part of the thing with the radio show, you know, was breaking a lot of talent. A lot of what you see with drum and bass now is the hard work we put in here, because every single guy that is doing okay has been on our show numerous times.
That's
and
right.
We've played their tunes first. That's something we can always be proud of.
This is Sensei. I can remember when Groove Rider first played one of my tracks, and I told my mother, and she was crying, you know, she was so happy for me, and, you know, it was really emotional for me as well.
Yo, Groove Rider, that tune right there is mad, sir. Stop that and bring it back.
This tune, man, is incredible. I've been ripping this tune the whole week, man. It's been killing places. This killed Fabi. This was a triple reload.
Yeah, for real.
You know, it's a triple reload.
Yeah, man.
I haven't even heard of the outfit before. Sensei.
Since then, I've just thought, I'm just going to work hard and make great music and just bring happiness to people, because I know that's what Fabio and Groove Rider do. They just bring happiness to so many people through the music.
Hi, my name's Chrissy Chris. They help someone like me. I used to listen to Fabio and Groove Rider a lot when I really wanted to be a radio DJ or have all the latest, freshest tracks. Everyone knows drum and bass on the radio for Fabio and Groove Rider, and for the tracks they've broken the scene and made big, and the guests they've had, and all the latest information, all the live broadcasts. It's shaped a lot of the scene.
Probably the biggest buzz we've ever got is having the first Radio 1 play from Groove Rider, which is cool.
Fred V and Graphics. Track entire One of These Days. Played first here on Rider Radio. 2011 business. 3 weeks in, I've got so many freshers.
Having a tune with a lot of hits on YouTube or MySpace is cool, but when it's your favourite DJ playing it to a massive audience, that's like way better.
I always thought they were really good presenters. They'd play good music and everything, but in terms of actually hosting the show, you'd always kind of laugh along with them and almost feel like you were there as well. So I always respected that.
What you see with the radio, that's us. That's the way we are in everyday life.
Can't fake it out.
Yeah, man. We ain't got a radio voice.
I can't hide
stuff,
man.
Like that.
I'm Phil Stocker. I produced Fab and Groove from June 2007 to September 2008. Working with them was just one of the most brilliant and wonderful experiences of my time here at Radio 1. They ooze enthusiasm for drum and bass. 5 minutes of getting in the studio with Fab and Groove, you're just nodding your head. Also, it was just really good fun. Fabs' laugh is infectious. Groove, when he gets his cackle on, is hilarious. I remember having to do links in the studio with them two or three times, because literally everyone just got the giggles.
Rider Radio, for sake. Phil, for sake.
Come on, man. If you've heard the show, they're some of the funniest guys you'll ever come across in your life.
Fabio and Sarah could get some busware, because we're taking them out tonight, Lindsay.
That's what you're liking. All right.
All right, so we're sending everybody home. Who else is in the building? We're sending them home too, Lidge. We've got a lot of busware to sort out.
Yeah, this is Dynamite MC checking in for the big boys, Fabio and Groove Rider. I'm a fan, and not because I'm in the scene or I'm part of the scene. It's an infectious, likable show with good music and good entertainment.
It's just always been something where if we were driving to a gig, or even before that, going raving, then that would be the show that we would listen to.
We're the Prototypes.
They both picked up on Cascade. It was part of the Battle of the Rewinds. They put us up against Danny Bird, Ill Behaviour, which was obviously a massive tune. I think it got into the top 40. We won.
Reload.
Right, ready. Yeah, don't hold on, Lisa. Hold on. Don't break the needle. Just wait. Patience. Right, after the drop. Oh my god, Lindsay, that one true, reload that tune, Lindsay.
Oh, no,
you smashed it, Lindsay.
Oh, Lindsay, you smashed it.
Oh my god,
Lindsay.
Let her reload.
Oh, Sarah, go home, seriously. Tell her, Lindsay.
Why am I going home? I didn't do the rewind. I can spin.
Come
on, my head.
Dark talk, Lindsay, come on.
You're shouting at me. So scared. Still a tune, though.
That's right, Lindsay. Gotta let
it go. It was really funny, too, actually, in the car coming back from a gig, and there was like four or five of us. Yeah! I think our mate said lighters up in the car and all sorts of stuff as it was playing, and like Groove Rider and Fabs are like, you know, battling each other and, you know, cussing each other and whatever else. It was so funny, but it's a memory that will last forever.
Oh, there's a lot of highlights off the top of my head. Going and doing an outside broadcast. We did the show from Detonate up in Nottingham with a ridiculous sound system that, even though I had earplugs in, it was nowhere near enough.
Somebody make some noise!
This is Lemon D, representing the Valve sound.
For a kid to be at home listening to those shows, it's kind of inspiring, especially if you're young and you can't go out.
Right, it's Dillinger from Valve.
Oh, it's wicked. That gives the people at home a taste of what it's actually like at a large event, the vibe and the crowd, and they can't see them, but they can hear the energy.
We were the first show to get Chasing Status in Maida Vale. That was a really big look. They'd never performed as a live band before, so they put that together especially for that.
Plan B, Chasing Status, BBC Maida Vale. Yo!
I remember when I used to feel something. I remember when I used to feel something. I remember when I used to feel something. I remember when I used to feel something.
Tony Coleman, also known as London Electricity. They represent with their taste making, and now they're not going to be on Radio 1, and I feel like I'm going to be lost and my sat nav's not going to work anymore. They were like the backbone. Drum and bass have supported new artists, unknown artists, underground artists, and I sincerely hope that Ed carries on that tradition.
Absolutely. They are the future of drum and bass music, so it's so important to push these new guys. I'm Ed, aka Friction. 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 As far as taking on the Radio 1 drum and bass show, I feel excited, but I'm nervous as well because it's some big shoes to fill, obviously. I'm just going to do things in my style and do my best to kind of represent every sort of element of drum and bass there is. So, guys, April the 2nd, I'm obviously taking over the show. What advice can you give me to see me through and do a job as half as good as you guys?
Change your pants every day.
Nah, Ed's a good guy, man.
Nah, he's safe.
He's a safe, safe guy. And, you know, at the end of the day, he'll be on here. You know, they've still got drum and bass here, and it couldn't happen to a better person. You know, good luck to him, man. Wish him all the best.
No doubt.
We'll be listening.
A really genuine note, they're really loyal. You know, they've been around in the game for so many years, but they're not full of themselves.
We try to interact with everybody. There's no boundaries with drum and bass, you know. It's open to anybody. There's no stigma, there's no criteria. Just have a passion of the music.
Size representing. We have a really very tight-knit family who always come out loyal. Kids that are 17 to 40 year olds, 50 year olds, and they all just seem to get along and appreciate the music.
Hi, this is High Contrast.
That's a common ground we share. That's something that unites everyone. There's a lot of people from diverse backgrounds into drum and bass, and we're all kind of brought together just through the love of the music. I thought I was the brat, the new kid, but I think now I'm actually part of the old school more as well.
Hi, my name's Chrissy Chris. I've grown up, you know, knowing Fabio and Groove Rider since I was very young, before I could probably even mix. They are my uncles.
Yeah, with Fred V and Graphics.
I suppose Fabio and Groove Rider are the godfathers? They're not granddads, they're the godfathers. There's all the different generations of people that come through, and slowly you move up in the ranks of the family, I guess.
I'd say we are
infants.
The teenagers.
Yeah.
This is Sensei. I'm still like a new kid on the block. Yeah, drum and bass is like a big family. Everyone respects everyone that's come before. It's really great to see Fabio and Groove Rider, the originators. The way they've nurtured drum and bass is just incredible.
Aliens, this is like alien music. You know, you have self-doubt sometimes, but then, you know, you go out and, you know, you get reassured.
It's really weird because I feel exactly the same way. I'm DJ Fresh. I was actually at a phase of my life where I was ready to throw the towel in. I don't know why, I don't know what was going on, but Groove Rider was like one of the people that I spoke to a lot and that reassured me and said, you know, dude, like, you're making great tunes and you've got to stick to your guns. And I think that's the kind of role that Groove Rider's had in a lot of people's careers. You know, he's almost like a drum and bass uncle. When people were talking about what I was going to follow Louder up with, it was really important to me that I used that moment that I had to shine it on a drum and bass track. Yeah, it's really, really special.
MCGQ, Fabio and Groove Rider are kings. Them guys was flying the flag first. They was carrying the flag before people was having number one. Do you know what I mean? Them guys, it helped these guys later on to be able to get what you got. They were sitting in the hot seat, do you know what I mean? And they was representing.
High Contrast. It's quite satisfying now to be playing at these huge dance music events all around the world and working with people like Tiësto and Underworld. It's been quite a journey.
One extra. D&B is amazingly successful. The thing about drum and bass people don't realise is if there's not a big party happening here, there's a massive one happening in Australia, and there's a massive one in New Zealand or Puerto Rico, we're playing in Brazil, we're playing in San Francisco. MC. It's a worldwide sound. That is the epitome of success, something that started very much a homegrown UK sound, spread internationally. You can't get more successful than that, you know. And of course, Fabio and Groove Rider played a massive part in that because they've been pioneers and they've been pushing the sound relentlessly and haven't waned or eased off or lost interest. No, they kept it 100, as the Americans say.
Hi, this is DJ Mikey. I came to England first time in 97 and I'm so shocked with the scene here. I think my best memory is when I played a home club. I played after Groove Rider. It's so wicked. When I play like Australia or New Zealand, something like that, it's very good. I feel really, really happy. It's so different because I never expect this in my whole life.
You know what I mean? You've had certain genres of music that have come and they've gone. With our music, when you think it's gone a bit stale, it reinvents itself again, do you know what I mean? And it's been doing that for years and years and years, and it will keep doing that.
Chris from The Prototypes. I think as long as the soul stays within it, whether that's dance floor, deep, minimal, tearing, whatever, dark, the soul has to talk to you and has to make you move.
Yeah.
And as long as drum and bass keeps you moving,
yeah,
we're sitting safe.
I'm DJ Fresh. I think it's really great that people are finally starting to back it in the UK because it's totally UK music. More and more talented people and more resources will gravitate towards the music, and it will encourage better music to be made, you know, and for the scene to grow. I think it's onwards and upwards. I think we're doing really well at the moment.
I'm not so sure, you know, what's going to happen next. Yeah, you know, I'm just like going to keep it as grimy and as gutter as I can, within reason, of course. But...
We've always done that. We've always kept it underground. It's something that, you know, we'll always do.
We're just moving from our radio show. It doesn't mean our life is over. Yeah. We're still going to do the things that we do anyway.
That's the spirit that we've always maintained throughout jungle, drum and bass. We're club DJs, and that's what we love doing more than anything else.
Do you know what? A rave DJ, that's what I am.
Yeah.
I
like that. Says it all.
If you want to have a party and you want to make it a good party, you've got to have Fabio and Groove Rider on your flyer. It's standard.
Show some respect. Enter the arena.
I want you to make the most noise for Fabio. And DJ
Fabio and Groove Rider love to mash it up, and I love to mash it up with them.
Fabio, they are the alpha and omega of this scene here, yeah? Ready to do battle.
The events, they kill it every time.
I think they're great DJs. I think they're sick and they go off hard.
My name is Netsky. They always play amazing sets. I've got so much respect for the guys.
This is Andy C from Ram Records, and I've got to big up Fabio and Groove Rider pushing drum and bass worldwide. Drum and bass is the way of life.
MC Biggie has always been two godfathers for me, and that's Fabio and Groove Rider. I'll be honest with you, this sicking on.
I love Fabio Groove Rider.
I do, I really do. With passion.
Groove used to always give me jokes, and Fabio always used to roll it out. Got to give props out to those guys because they kicked it real. Randall out of here.
Yeah, this is MC Depp. Big up the Fabio and the Groove Rider. Long time in the business.
Foundation. Institution.
My name is Jumping Jack Frost.
Brian G.
Fabio and Groove Rider. I was in awe of them guys. I was like, whoa.
Wicked, wicked. Jungle is massive.
Yes, this is DJ SS. And we couldn't have done this without you. Big up Groove. Big up Fabio.
Yeah, this is your boy MC Skibbity. They just represent drum and bass. It's in their hearts. It's in their souls. In their blood.
All I can say is Celia.
Yeah, I'm Magistrate, Fabio and Groove Rider. Just changed my whole direction to what I'm doing.
Off the hook.
MC Magica.
Grime.
They are the leading figures. They were there from the very beginning and they'll be there till the very end.
They tore up the dance.
That was the story of drum and bass. That was the story of Fabio and Groove Rider. Coming up later tonight, the final show. We're going to have special guests on BBC Radio 1, 2, 2.